find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand.
Good morning, and welcome to the online worship service of the Cross Tower Church of Christ. I'm Randy Clay, the teaching minister at the Cross Tower Church. Imagine this scenario, this story. About 1967-ish, I'm the youngest of four children, the youngest of three brothers. So my brothers were always messing with me and putting me up to something. So my mother, around Easter time, we had this family tradition of getting food dye, boiling eggs, then hiding the eggs around the yard. Then when we found them a couple times, we'd do that a couple times, and then we would eat the eggs. Well, most of them. I would not eat the eggs. I would give my eggs away because I hate eggs. So one year, my older brother went to me and said, "Hey, I'll give you $5 if you let me crack three eggs on top of your head." Man, to a kid at 1967, third grade, $5 was like $1,000. I said, promise? And he said, promise. And so he cracked the first egg. It ran over me. He's like, oh, $5, $5. I can do this. Second egg went over me. And I was anticipating the third egg and getting my $5. And he just runs off laughing. And I said, hey, where's my $5? He said, I didn't do the third egg. I don't owe you anything. Broken promises, right? Now that story did not happen, but it could have happened. We've all known the frustration and the emptiness, maybe even the anger that we feel when a promise to us is broken. And then we get to think, is God like that? Does God keep his promises? Can I count on God fulfilling his promises? So we've been looking at the promises of God the past several weeks. In the Bible, there's over 7,000 promises recorded. In fact, there's 7,500 and something. For our purposes, we're looking at just 6 or 7 of them. And looking at that, God keeps every promise he's ever made. Every one. In fact, the Bible says that God is not like man who does not change his mind. And the Bible also tells us that it's impossible for God to lie. So when God says something, you can count on it. You can take it to the bank. It's rock solid. So today we're going to look at the greatest promise, this promise of Easter, the promise of resurrection that the whole Bible hinges on. If the resurrection doesn't happen, the Bible is not true. None of the Bible is true. Jesus promised, kill me and in 3 days I will rise again. He kept saying that over and over. And his disciples never understood what he was talking about until the resurrection. Then they began to put it all together. So let's look at some hidden and some empty objects that show to us the promise of Easter, the promise of resurrection. I like how one man has said it. Instead of promise full of emptiness, God gives us emptiness that's full of promise. So we're going to look at two empty things that are full of promise. The first one is the empty cross. If on that Saturday after the crucifixion, and you would see the empty cross laying on the ground, baptized in the blood of the Son of God, Jesus, fully man, but he was fully God. God was on that cross. The Old Testament, they would sacrifice every year. They would get a lamb that was without blemish, without spot, and sacrifice it for their sin. But they'd have to do that every year. Jesus was called the Lamb of God. When John the Baptist saw him coming, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So Jesus was the once and for all perfect sacrifice for our sin. In fact, Paul puts it this way in his letter to the Colossians. You were dead in sins, and your sinful desires were not yet cut away. Then he gave you a share in the very life of Christ. For he forgave all your sins. He forgave all your sins and blotted out the charges against you, made against you, the list of his commandments which you had not yet obeyed. He took this list of sins and destroyed it by nailing it to Christ's cross. That phrase, blotted out, means that when they would write with their ink on their paper, on their papyrus, and they made a mistake, they take the sponge while the ink would, and they would dab, and they would soak up that word that they made a mistake on, and now they look at their mistake and it was gone. Like that word was never there. That's what Paul says is your sins. It's as if Christ has blotted out your sins, they're gone, as if they were never there. So the empty cross stands as this reminder, this powerful reminder that our sins, all our sins, are forgiven. They are nailed to the cross of Christ. The second thing that is empty that fulfills this promise of Easter is the empty tomb. Pick it up in John chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. Matthew tells us that when Mary was there, angels suddenly appeared to them, to John and Peter, who ran to the tomb as well. The angel said, "Do not be afraid. I know that you were looking for Jesus, who's been crucified. He is not here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said he would. Come and see the place where his body was." In John 20, as we go back to John, that when Peter and John go to the tomb, and that scripture tells us that John looked in, that he saw and he believed. The third hidden empty object was the grave clothes. They saw the grave clothes that they wrapped Jesus in, and now those very strips of cloth are folded up neatly because those clothes are empty as well. Another emptiness that fulfills promise of Easter. But Jesus was in this tomb, bought, paid for by Joseph of Arimathea, who was a wealthy man. And he and Nicodemus had wrapped Jesus up. They were secret disciples until the death of Jesus, and now they've gotten their courage. And it says that back in John 19, in the place where Jesus was, there was an, in accordance with the that Christ was wrapped up in accordance with the Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in that garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was a Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. And so can you picture this conversation with Joseph that next Saturday after that crucifixion on Friday? "Hey, Joseph, why did you give your tomb to this carpenter that was crucified as a criminal? Why would you do that?" And Joseph said, "Hey, look, it's no big deal. Jesus only needed for the weekend," right? So Jesus promised that in 3 days, I would rise again. And so Peter and John and Mary Magdalene and the other women went to the tomb, and now, a couple of days ago, their faith was, they were discouraged and they were distraught and they were disappointed. And now, because the tomb is empty, their hopes are new. They are excited. They are full of hope, because the empty tomb reminds us that there is something beyond this life. There is something beyond our graves. There is that Jesus has overcome the ultimate enemy of all of us, and that is death. Spiritual, physical death and spiritual death, that now, because of the empty tomb, we can have this hope of living with God for eternity, of being with him, of having eternal life. I know that a lot of us have put our faith in so many things. Some of us have put our faith in the economy. Now the economy's tanked. Maybe take it years for it to recover. We put our faith in our careers, and now we've been furloughed. Hope you get your job back, by the way. Many of us now are in fear of the COVID-19, and now maybe we've known someone now that's been affected and have maybe perhaps even passed away from this virus. So today, I want to encourage you to put your faith in the promises of God, that God fulfills and keeps every promise. I know of a lot of us have been frustrated with unfulfilled promises. God fulfills every promise. You can put your faith and your hope in Christ. The cross is empty. The tomb is empty. That promise, the ultimate promise, has been fulfilled. And you wonder, how can I put my faith in Christ? Well, today I would encourage you, as Peter says, I'm going to give you Peter's invitation. I'll give you his same answer. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the forgiveness of your sins. and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Repenting, turning around, go. Your life's going that way. Now your life's going to be going this way. Now you put your faith in other things. Now you're going to put your faith in Jesus. Be baptized, be immersed, reenact that death, burial, and resurrection. If you would call me, text me, private message me here on the Christ Tower Facebook page, we will love to get with you, study with you, and talk about putting your faith in these incredible fulfilled promises of God and putting your faith in Christ. And you can live with Him. You can have the promise of eternal life. You know, our sins are many, but God's grace is overwhelmingly incredible. That God's grace, His amazing grace, covers all your sin. If you put your faith in Him, if you reenact the death, burial, and resurrection, and you believe that He's the Son of God, today can be your Easter. Today can be your resurrection from your watery grave of baptism, and that you can be raised to walk in newness of life. We would love to talk about your relationship with God. Text me, private message me. Well, thanks for joining us this Easter. I think those are very powerful and encouraging words. The empty cross and the empty tomb, so that your heart can be full of the love of Christ. Be blessed. We'll see you next Sunday.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving ceased. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones He came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on Him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave He rose again. And as He stands for victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am His and He is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from His hand. Till He returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Hello, I'm Dale Cannon, one of the shepherds here at the Cross Tower Church of Christ. And I've got some good news for you today. Are you ready for good news after all the bad news we've been hearing the last couple of weeks? I know I am. Well, what I have to share with you today is the most exciting, best news ever. And I mean ever. It's not news about something that's just happened, but rather it's news about something that happened almost 2,000 years ago. The Apostle Paul tells us what's most important about that good news in just two sentences. He boils it down to two things in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, starting in verse 3. He says, Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said. He was buried, and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said. This is exciting good news. It's important good news, Paul says, because it's by that good news that we are being saved if we believe it and if we hold on to that faith. Both the death of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus are important. As Randy points out in today's sermon, there was an empty cross and an empty tomb. The cross is important because on the cross, Jesus died for our sins. Through the grace and the mercy of God, we are justified in his presence because of the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. But the resurrection is also important. And it's important for a lot of reasons. You'll find lots of reasons in the New Testament for why the resurrection is important. But Paul says here in this chapter that it is important because if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, then we won't be raised from the dead. If Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, then everything we believe about Jesus is false, and our faith is a waste of time, and we are among all men to be most pitied. But in fact, Jesus did rise from the dead. That tomb was empty on that Easter morning. And because of that, we have the promise that one day, if we die before the Lord returns, our tomb will be empty too, and we will be raised, and we will be given a new body, a body that will not die, a body that is imperishable, a body that won't be subject to pandemics. We won't worry about viruses that might make us sick, and we'll be free from the pandemic of sin as well. That is really great news, isn't it? And that's great news that we remember and we announce and we celebrate every time we take the Lord's Supper. Paul says earlier in the same letter, back in chapter 11, for every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes. And that's what we're going to do now as we commune together. We are going to declare our faith in the resurrection. We are going to remember the sacrifice on the cross, and we are going to look forward to his second coming. What great news that is. Let's pray. Holy Father, we thank you for this exciting good news. We thank you for the death of Jesus on the cross. We're thankful for the sacrifice he made for our sins. We're thankful that we can stand cleansed of those sins in your presence by your grace and by your mercy. And we're thankful that just as Jesus was raised from the dead, that we too, one day, will stand in your presence with bodies that are not subject to sin and are not subject to death. We remember this and we declare this to be true as we eat this bread and as we drink this cup. In Jesus' name.
Well, it was many years ago in the time of the Bible that they took him up to Calvary. They could have let him go, but instead they chose Barabbas just to set another criminal free. When they crucified the ever-loving, caring master with compassion flowing from his eyes. Well, he said to a thief who was begging him for mercy that today you live in paradise. And I'm saved like the criminal on the cross. Praise God, I'm saved.
I'm saved.
No more to suffer loss. Well, he said I'd live in paradise.
He's taking care of the cost. Hallelujah, I'm saved.
I'm saved like the criminal on the cross. Well, on the judgment day, when all the people gather around him and they wait to hear what he will declare, there will never ever be more intense anticipation than has ever happened anywhere. When they call my name to defend my reputation, there is only one thing I can say. I'm a wretch, I'm a worm, I'm a no good sinner, but he said I'll save you.
I'm saved
like the criminal on the cross. Praise God, I'm saved.
I'm saved. No more to suffer loss.
Hey, he said I'd live in paradise.
And he's taking care of the cost. Hallelujah, I'm saved.
I'm saved like the criminal on the cross. But don't you know that I'm saved?
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved
through Jesus. I am saved.
Jesus, I am
well,
saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
His mercy showed the way.
His mercy
well,
showed
I'm
the way.
Saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved. No more for me to say.
No more for me to
well,
say.
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved in paradise today.
Yes. Many years ago, the time of the Bible, they took him up to Calvary. They could have let him go, but instead they chose Barabbas to set another criminal free.
Just to say
and when they crucified the ever-loving, caring master with compassion flowing from his eyes, he said to a thief who was begging him for mercy that today you're living. And I'm so glad I'm saved.
I'm saved like the criminal on the cross.
Praise God, I'm saved.
I'm saved.
I'm saved.
No more suffer.
He said I'd live in paradise.
And he's taking care of the cost. Hallelujah, I'm saved.
I'm saved
like the criminal on the cross.
I'm saved.
I'm